Good morning.
Good morning.
And welcome to our worship on this beautiful and slightly snowy Sunday morning. We're grateful that you've donned your greatest, warmest sweater and have joined us for worship today. We're glad to be gathered together in the warmth of the Holy Spirit to praise God together. As we begin, just a few announcements we want to make, just to catch you up on some things that are happening around the life of the church. To start off with, if you're sitting here near the center aisle, you're probably sitting on or near a clipboard. And I want you to grab a hold of that clipboard and fill out the information on that sheet and send that on down the pew. And as it gets to you, if you don't recognize a name or two on that list, make sure you change that by the end of our service and introduce yourself to the people that have gathered around you on this Sunday morning. And I also want to bring to your attention on the back of those clipboards are some prayer cards tucked into a little pouch there. We normally have a time in our service where we do pass around a microphone and lift up our joys and concerns. But we are not going to be doing that today, as we are going to be doing a special prayer and honoring our veterans and lifting them up in prayer. So we're not going to be doing our joys and concerns as we typically do. So if you have a joy or concern that you would like us to be keeping in prayer this week, please take advantage of those prayer cards. Fill one of those out. You can put it in the offering plate. Hand it to me on your way out. You can get it to one of our ushers, and we will pass that along to our prayer warriors and keep you in prayer throughout this week. So take advantage of that if you have a prayer request. That's very important. We also want to invite you to join us in the fellowship hall. So much to do back in the fellowship hall today. Of course, there's always the goodies and the coffee, and of course, there's no better way to stave off having to go out into the snowy, wintry landscape than a nice warm cup of coffee. So grab a cup of coffee, find yourself at a table, catch up with some old friends, make some new friends, and enjoy some time together in fellowship. And while you're back there, we've got some cards, our table cards, right there on the podium. Sign those on your way out. But we also have a table of cards. These are the Christmas cards. Levita is starting the OCC effort to get Christmas cards out to some of our shut-ins and those who are far-flung and can't always be with us. We want to remember them this upcoming Christmas season, so we want to start signing those, and to save you and I a hand cramp, we're going to put them out a little bit at a time. So there's a dozen or so on a table there. Stop by the table, fill those out, and make sure that folks know that we love them and that we're thinking about them this Christmas. We also have broadcasters, etc., that you can pick up as well. So make it back into fellowship time. Lots to do back there. We also have opportunities abounding for you to plug in and grow as a disciple of Jesus Christ, and we're always wanting to do that. So I want to challenge you to plug into one of our groups. If you don't have a group already, we've got class meetings and Bible studies and prayer meetings and all kinds of things that happen throughout the week. Would love for you to find that group and plug in. Just so everyone knows, we've got Sunday school after the fellowship time today. Of course, my group is going to be wrapping up the Isaiah study, the Epic of Eden Isaiah study. And we're going to be transitioning next week into a short study that'll take us through the end of the year on the book of Ruth, the Old Testament book of Ruth. So we're very excited about that. Don't feel like you have to have completed the first two studies to jump in. These are all independent studies, and so if you have been wondering about maybe jumping in, you're looking for the right time, well, guess what? Next week is the right time. Come and join us for Ruth. We'd love to have you plug in. You can get information from me about that, of course. Of course, today is Veterans Day. It is the 100th anniversary of the armistice that ended World War I. Can we just praise God for peace in that time? And tomorrow, even though today is officially Veterans Day, tomorrow is the day we observe Veterans Day, for those of you who get that day off. And the Boy Scouts are going to be, during their normal Monday evening meeting, I don't know if you've ever been around a Monday evening, but the Boy Scouts are running all over the place. It's a beautiful, thunderous noise. And we love having them here. There's so many of them now. But this Monday, tomorrow at 7:15, is that right? Do I have the right? Yeah, 7:15, out in our parking lot, weather permitting, of course, they are going to be doing a flag retirement ceremony and an honoring of veterans for Veterans Day. So if you want to be here for a part of that, 7:15 tomorrow evening for a flag retirement and Veterans Day honoring there. So join the Boy Scouts for that tomorrow. Now, we've got a busy week coming up. Wednesday is, of course, our big Thanksgiving meal for Wonderful Wednesday. We're cooking up a big old Thanksgiving meal, and I say, by we, I mean Jim Farrell is going to be cooking up a big Thanksgiving meal for all of us, and would love you have it. Yes, so thank you to Jim, and we'd love to have you join us for that. So please come for the Thanksgiving meal. After the meal, we're going to have our all-church meeting, which is in place of our traditional charge conference meeting. That's going to be a gathering. We're going to celebrate the things that we've accomplished this past year. We're going to look forward to what's happening next year. We're going to make a few key decisions for our church that we can then take on Saturday. We're having a joint charge conference at the Fort Lupton United Methodist Church up there in Fort Lupton. And we meet with nine other United Methodist churches for a circuit charge conference. So if you want to join us for that, you'd like information, please come and find me. I'd love to share with you about that. But would really love for you to come get some turkey and stick around for a celebration of our ministry and make some important decisions. So want to invite you to that. While you're back signing your cards for Christmas, we also want to draw your attention to a sign-up sheet that's back there on the table there, and that is for the delivering of hot Thanksgiving meals on Thanksgiving morning. The Elks and the Kiwanis and several other groups partner with the Sheriff's Office and all to provide hot, cooked Thanksgiving meals to folks in need in our community, and we have helped over the course of the last, 7 or 8 years with delivering of those on Thanksgiving morning. So what a joy and a blessing it is to be able to just pick up some food and to drop it off at a home of somebody who is really going to appreciate and benefit from that. And so if you'd like to help us deliver those Thanksgiving meals, you're going to want to find Levita for details, and that sign-up sheet is in the back by those cards. So sign the Christmas card, sign up to deliver Thanksgiving meals, you'll be all set. I told you there was a lot to do back there at in the fellowship time. So help with that. As the wintry weather has betrayed, we are barreling toward Advent. Before too long, we are going to have the Christmas decorations up, and that means that the bell choir is going to be preparing to do some Christmas caroling. If you would like to join the bell choir, maybe learn in a short-term way to ring some bells and to have some fun and fellowship with the rest of the bell ringers. We won't quite call them ding-a-lings, will we? But make a joyful noise for the Lord. You can find Mel. Mel is the director of our bell choir, and she would love to show you how to do that and to incorporate you in for those carolings. So if you've ever wanted to give the bells a try in a non-threatening way, check out the caroling. They're going to start rehearsing 7:15 this Tuesday. So drop in for that and learn for that, but you can talk to Mel for more information. A very important thing we need your help with is the hanging of the greens. I don't know, I put my Christmas lights on the house yesterday, thank goodness. I know. Well, you know, you got to take advantage of a 60-degree day in November. So I put the lights on the house. They're not plugged in yet, okay? Before you start throwing tomatoes. They're not plugged in yet, okay? But they are on the house, and with the snow outside, I'm very grateful that they're up on the house already. But it takes a lot. If you've ever decorated your home, you know it takes a lot to kind of make that happen. Well, the same is true of God's house, and it takes a lot of people to put up all of the greens and the beautiful decorations. We appreciate every Advent. So that happens traditionally the Saturday after Thanksgiving. This year, that's November the 24th. It's usually a morning project. We're usually done by lunchtime. We're going to start at 8:30, and we would love to have as many people here to help shoulder that burden and make it go quickly. We can transform this sanctuary into a beautiful space for our Advent season. So join us for Hanging of the Greens on Saturday, November 24th. You can also help us with some decorating for the Advent season as we prepare for that season. One really important way you can do it and honor the loved one, a loved one in your life, someone that you want to just honor, someone that you would like to remember who has passed, you can purchase a poinsettia or two or three or four, and those poinsettias are delivered before the end of Advent, and they beautify our sanctuary for Christmas Eve. It's such a beautiful way to just punctuate the wonderful decorations and a great way to honor a loved one in your life, and then you get to take that home after the Christmas season. So if you would like to purchase a poinsettia, you can see the members of the worship committee. They will be in the fellowship hall as well for that. And one last thing that you can help us do, be thinking ahead. I know the snow has everybody thinking Christmas, right? Think ahead. Not really. Some of you are like, whew. As we get into the Advent season, we have a marvelous tradition here at the church where we invite you to sign up to bring your home nativity scene here to the church and share it with us on Sunday mornings throughout Advent. And so if you would like to, if you have a nativity scene that means something to you, or you have one that is just particularly awesome and you'd love to share it with us, we would love, we love the variety of the Advent wreaths and or the Advent nativity scenes, and we'd love to have you share that with us. So if you have a nativity scene you'd like to sign up, there's a sign-up sheet in Fellowship Hall. So basically, you're going to spend the rest of Sunday in the Fellowship Hall. That's what I'm telling you. So come and join us for that time. And yes, I have a waving of a hand.
Okay, then
Marvelous. We are? You just got voluntold, Rick. All right, now, hot off presses. I know we've got a lot of announcements. It's that kind of busy season, but I've got hot results from the chili cook-off last night. So for everyone's information, we have the results. So the most unusual chili. We had our chili cook-off. You all know the chili cook-off, right? People bring different chilies. You try them off. The people vote, and fun is had by all. Well, the most unusual chili, the award for the most unusual chili goes to the Sheely family. There we are. Most unusual chili. We had a sweep of the green and hottest chilies. Both go to Dale Friedholm up here in the marvelous there. We had the wimpiest chili. The wimpiest chili. That goes to Deb Friedholm. I'm not sure how the hottest chili and the wimpiest chili came out of the same kitchen, but you can talk to them later if you want. The best non-chili goes to our very own Lori Prince. Yep. And the best overall chili also is Lori Prince. So if you would like a great chili recipe, I'm sure that she would love to share that with you. Or maybe she would not love to share that with you. We'll leave that in the hands of Christian Fellowship after the service. And well, as we begin our worship service this morning, let us greet each other in the peace and love of Christ.
Avoid getting people sick. I'll just wave at you guys as nicely as I can.
No one ever comes up here.
Good morning.
Good morning, guys.
How are you doing?
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Oh,
be seated. We are invited into worship on this glorious morning through the words of Psalm 100. Psalm 100, it begins, "Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with singing. Know that the Lord is God. It is he that made us, and we are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him. Bless his name. For the Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness to all generations." We come to this place not just to gather with friends. We come here in the midst of our friendship, our fellowship together, to gather in God's presence, to sing praises to the one who made us, who holds us, who encourages us, who sustains us. We come to give thanks and praise because God, in his creating and his sustaining, in his loving, in his providing, is forever faithful. We come in his faithfulness to humble ourselves before him here in his presence. Let us enter God's presence together. Let us pray. Holy and gracious God, we gather before you with thanksgiving in our hearts, filled to overflowing with your love and abundance. We come here knowing that we cannot do it ourselves. We come here to humble ourselves before you, to give of our lives, to hand over our time and our energies, to bring our songs of praise and worship. We come here to lay them at your feet, that they might be acceptable in your sight. Lord, come, meet us in this place by the power of your Holy Spirit. Come into our hearts that they might be strangely warmed. Come into our minds that we might be truly inspired. Lord, take hold of our lives. Transform us to your glory. Fill us with your Holy Spirit, overflowing into all the world. Do it now, we pray. In Jesus' powerful and precious name, amen. Humble ourselves before the Lord, we're also humbled at the sacrifice of so many who have pledged their time and energies, their very lives, to protecting the freedoms of our nation. And on this Veterans Day, we have prepared, and I mean Lori Prince has prepared a wonderful slideshow for us and updated it continually over the years to celebrate those in our midst who have served in our armed forces. And so I commend this presentation to your prayerful experience. We could just invite all of those who have served in our armed forces to just stand, that we might recognize and thank you for your service to our country. And now I want to invite the children down front for just a moment. Well, how are you guys doing today? Good? Are you sure? Did any of you have relatives up on the screen there during that time? Yeah, some of you did. Yeah. Got a mom and a brother. Yeah, all kinds of folks. Well, what do you suppose we have in the box today? Any guesses? Don't ask you? Okay, I won't. Any guesses? Nothing? You guys are unusually quiet. It's a little scary. I thought I wasn't supposed to ask you. I'm just kidding. What do you think? Air? Could be air. Yeah, it could be. I got about a dozen air sermons for that. I do, just in case. Shall we find out? All right, let's check it out. There's a piece of bacon. Man, I tell you what. Bacon. Well. Oh, I appreciate that. That's excellent. Is this left over from breakfast? Awesome. Very good. I'm surprised a piece of bacon made it out of breakfast. That never happens in my house, I tell you what. There are devourers that come down on bacon in my house. Well, that's probably one of the more unusual things I've ever gotten before. I like it. I know, and Deb didn't have anything to do with it. Well, how do you suppose we're gonna see God in a piece of bacon today? What do you think? You don't know? You do? So just like we eat food, like bacon, for fuel, God fuels us with his love. I like that. Very good. Very good. I like that. Any other ideas? What do you think, Troy? We got a plate under the bacon, supporting it, keeping it from, you know, getting germs from the box and hands and stuff. So just like God supports us, I like that. That's good, too. That's good. Got our budding theologians out in force today, huh? What's that?
The circle of life.
The circle of life. This bacon once was a pig, and now it is bacon. Absolutely. Absolutely. Well, I'll tell you what. I don't know about you, but I find that absolutely everything is better with bacon. Amen. Can you think of some things that bacon makes better? Cheeseburgers, absolutely, cheeseburgers. Any other things? Peanut butter and bacon. Now that's a woman after my own heart. Peanut butter and mayonnaise and bacon?
Yep.
Wow. We got the BLT, okay. Put it on a sandwich, for sure. Yep.
Just bacon.
Just bacon. Just give me a whole plate of bacon. That's what we need. Bacon and egg goes great for breakfast, right? Right? You know, one of the most unusual things that I've had that's really quite good? You get a maple donut. You know, a donut with the maple frosting on it? With bacon.
Really?
On the maple frost. Oh, yeah. A maple bacon donut. I'm telling you what. I've been joking about how, you know, no one's going to come and pry that third donut out of my hand. There might be fourth or fifth donuts involved when there's maple bacon donuts. They're that good. Y'all going to go home and try them now, aren't you? They're that good. I'm telling you, they're very good. It sounds weird. I've heard bacon jelly. Have you seen bacon jelly? Yeah? And bacon and chocolate. Oh, you put bacon in anything, right? You know what's funny, though? What's funny about bacon, it makes everything better. It really does. It makes everything better. You might not agree with me, but I think bacon makes everything better. Okay. See, the thing is we can live our lives without God, but our lives are always better with God. And in fact, God is so much better than bacon because God doesn't just add a little bit of flavoring to our life. God is really the most important thing in our lives. And without God, we're kind of empty inside. Right? Kind of like a BLT wouldn't be worth it if it didn't have the B, right? See? I'm telling you. So, the next time you guys are having some bacon in the morning, okay? Or maybe when you go back to children's church and you split this up somehow. I'm not sure how you're going to leave it with me. Well, I got to talk, so I'm going to leave the bacon with you. I'm going to show restraint, okay? But I appreciate that. I can eat it after church. See, he's looking out for me. Thank you. Way to go, buddy. So the next time you see bacon on anything, okay, even a donut, I want you to think, you know what? I need God in my life, because with God in my life, everything is so much better. Okay? Does that sound like a good plan? All right. I'll leave that. You watch that for me, all right? Very good. Who wants to bring next week? Anybody want to bring for the youth next week? Do you want to stump the youth? Yeah? Do we want to put your sister in charge of the box? I just got a blank stare. Okay, you bring for next week? Okay, you bring for next week. Is that all right? Okay. A confirmation from Mom. Okay. Can we all have a hand? Let's have a prayer. All right, let's pray. Gracious and loving God, we are so thankful to have you in our lives because we know that everything is better with you. Lord, show us every day how we are better with you in our lives. In fact, how you are the very core of who we are. Lord, we thank you for these children, for all the wonderful ways that they share your love and grace with us each and every day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, and you guys can go back to your families or to Children's Church.
All the children of the world, red and yellow, black and white, they are precious in his sight. Jesus loves the little children of the world.
We're actually not going to do joys and concerns today. Our youth are so, like, on top of it. I know, I stole their job. As we honored our veterans, and as we remember the 100th anniversary of Armistice, that's such a marvelous origin for our celebration of all of our veterans. And we also want to keep in mind, as we saw several folks whose end date in the military is non-existent because they're currently still in the military, still stationed all across the world, protecting freedom and fighting for what is right in this world. So we want to lift them up in prayer. Those in our midst who have served in prayer. And so we're going to come together, and I'm going to invite us into a time of silent prayer. Perhaps there's somebody in your life that wasn't able to be included in our slideshow. Maybe there's somebody on your heart that you want to lift up, somebody you know, a friend, whatever it might be. Take this moment and just lift up silently the people in your life who have served and that you are grateful for. And then we are going to join together in a litany. That the response is in your bulletin. It's, we give thanks, God is the response. And so just be listening for that as we go through. But let us enter into the presence of God in prayer on behalf of those who have served in our armed forces. Gracious and loving God, we entrust the names of these men and women who have given so selflessly for the protection and the freedom of others. We lift them up in prayer in the litany that we join together. Let us give thanks to God for the land of our birth with all its chartered liberties, for all the wonder of our country's story. The people say, we give thanks, O God, for leaders in nation and state, and for those who in days past and in these present times have labored for the commonwealth. We give you thanks, O God, for those who in all times and in all places have been true and brave, in the world's common ways have lived upright lives and ministered to their fellow man. We give thanks, O God, for those who served their country in its hour of need, and especially for those who gave even their lives in that service. We give you thanks, O God, for all those who are serving still, placing lives in harm's way, that we might be free. We give you thanks, O God. Almighty God and most merciful Father, as we remember these your servants, remembering with gratitude their courage and strength, we hold before you those who mourn them. Look upon your bereaved servants with your mercy. At this day, bring them memories of those they have lost a while. May it also bring your consolation and the assurance that their loved ones are alive now and forever in your presence. We lift them up to you, Lord. We entrust them all to you in the powerful and precious name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, the one who taught us how to live, who shows us how to love, and who brings us together in prayer as we now join our Father, who art in heaven. Hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. May we join our hearts and voices together as we now join in our hymn response, America the Beautiful. It's hymn number 696. May we stand and join together as we do. Today is Acts 1:11, verse 93 in the Bible.
but a man named Ananasa, with the consent of his wife, Sapphira, sold a piece of property. With his wife's knowledge, he kept back some of the proceeds and brought only a part and laid it at the apostles' feet. Ananasa, Peter asked, "Why has Satan filled your heart to lie in the Holy Spirit and to keep back part of the proceeds of the land? While it remained unsold, did it not remain your own? And after it was sold, were not the proceeds at your disposal? How is it that you have contrived this deed in your heart? You did not lie to us, but to God." Now when Ananias heard these words, he fell down and died. The great fear seized all who heard of it. The young man came and wrapped up his body, then carried him out and buried him. After an interval of about 3 hours, his wife came in. Not knowing what had happened, Peter said to her, "Tell me whether you and your husband sold the land for such and such a price." And she said, "Yes, that was the price." Then Peter said to her, "How is it that you have agreed together to put the Spirit of the Lord to the test? Look, the feet of those who have buried their husband is at the door, and they are carrying you out." Immediately she fell down at his feet and died. When the young men came in, they found her dead, so they carried her out and buried her beside her husband. And great fear seized the whole church and all who heard all these things. The love of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Grace be yours and peace from Jesus Christ our Lord. We're in the midst of this series we're calling Life-Changing Thoughts. They're based on the passage that we're based on is from Romans. Paul's letter to the Romans in chapter 12, verse 2 reads, "Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your minds, so that you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect." Be transformed by the renewing of your minds. The premise for our series is that you cannot change your life as much as you'd like to. You cannot change your life, but you can change your thoughts. And if you change your thoughts, God will change your life. We get these life-changing thoughts from the Word of God, and so our series has us mining the Word of God for some life-changing thoughts, some things that we need to be thinking differently about, so that we can have the mind of Christ about some things in our life. And in changing our thoughts, God will change our lives. Today's life-changing thought is giving is for our sake. Giving is for our sake. We often think about giving for the sake of others, don't we? When we engage in the idea of giving, you know, there's somebody who might be hungry, what do? We give them food, right? We, coming up on the Thanksgiving holiday, we're collecting canned goods, right, for those baskets to go out. We're planning to deliver food. If someone's hungry, we give them food. We give for someone else's sake. Someone is cold, we give them shelter or perhaps a coat. We've been collecting coats in the back. There's a big red box for you to bring your coats if you haven't brought your coats yet. Someone is down and out, we might give them some money. We might help them out with a bus ticket or a place to stay for the night or some gas for the car or something, right? For their sake, we bring. A natural disaster hits, a wildfire burns down a whole area, or a tsunami takes out a village, or a hurricane comes and wipes out the coast. What do we good Methodists do? We give to UMCOR, right? For their sake, so that they might have a place one day. We respond. When we often think about giving, we think about how it helps others. Someone, there's a need, and we meet that need. We have the ability, so we meet it. But what happens when we apply that same mentality to our giving to God? You ever think about that? If our mode of giving is always for the sake of the person you're giving to, right? Someone's hungry, you give them food. Someone's cold, you give them shelter. Someone's in need, you provide a need that you might be able to meet. But what happens when we apply that same mentality to God? Does God have a need that only you and I can meet? Does God have any need at all? God has a need that only we can meet? God doesn't need anything. God doesn't need anything. God is the creator of the heavens and the earth. God spoke the mountains into existence. God said, and the sea parted, and the land appeared. The word of God came forth, and the world teemed with every animal you can think of. And so God doesn't need to give because God has a need. You ever think about that? God doesn't need our contribution in order to keep this church going. Did you know that? God doesn't need that to keep us. The church is not going to crumble because you or I do not give to a church. God's church will prevail. God does not have a need for us. God desires us. That's different. But God does not have a need. God does not have some sort of need that only we can meet. Not in the same sense that someone coming in out of the cold today might need a coat. Or someone without a home might need a shelter. Or someone without food might need food. Not in that same sense. The answer is no. God doesn't need anything. God created everything, including you and me. God doesn't need anything from us, so why tithe? Why the tithe? Y'all know what a tithe is, right? A tithe is Hebrew for tenth, okay? So a tenth of what is asked. The Old Testament talks more about the tithe than the afterlife. Did you know that? You realize that? The Old Testament talks more about the tithe than afterlife. The tithe is first introduced in the law. Of course, it happens. Abraham tithes, gives a tenth to God in praise, and others throughout the Holy Scriptures, particularly in the Old Testament, give a tenth, right? But tithe makes its way into the law when we get into Leviticus 27. Okay, a tenth of everything a person has from the Lord. A little clue there, everything you have from the Lord is everything you have. Follow me? Okay? You don't have anything that didn't come from the Lord. Okay? So when the law spells this out, it's a tenth of all of the grain harvest and all of the spices that you have and all of the cattle you might have and all of the other livestock that you might have and all of the things that God has provided. A tenth of that, the first tenth, in fact. The first fruits of the harvest belong to God. That's what the tithe is. But I like the way Malachi, in the last book, if you want to turn with me to Malachi, it's the last chapter before Matthew. It's the last book before Matthew, okay? The last book of our Old Testament, unless you have the Apocrypha in there, and you might. But the last chapter, chapter 3, just watch how the prophet outlines this. He says, starting in chapter 3, verse 10, it says, bring the full tithe into the storehouse, that's the house of the Lord, so that there may be food in my house. This is God speaking through the prophet. Okay? Bring the full tithe into the storehouse so that there may be food in my house. And thus put me to the test, says the Lord of hosts. See if I will not open the windows of heaven for you and pour down for you an overflowing blessing. I will rebuke the locust for you. Some other translations say devourer. I always thought it was kind of a cool concept, right? Instead of locust, but that's what they mean, the locust devour, right? I will rebuke the locust, the devourer, for you, so that it will not destroy the produce of your soil, and your vine in the field shall not be barren, says the Lord of hosts. Then all the nations will count you happy. For you will be a land of delight, says the Lord of hosts. Bring it into the storehouse so that there might be food in my house. Test the Lord and see if God will not open the windows of heaven. Now, in some circles, that gets translated as give to the church and God will give you everything you ever wanted. I'm not here to sell you that bill of goods today, okay? That's not what the gospel says. But God is saying, do you trust me? Do you trust me to provide for you? Do you trust me? One mistake we make with the tithe is assuming that we give the 10% to God and we can do whatever we want with the 90%. You ever think about that? Well, I give my 10% to God, and that way the rest of this 90% is all mine. I can do whatever I want. Doesn't matter what it is. I want to do it. I can do it. It's my 90%. But, as I said before, we do not have anything that did not come from God. What you have is from the Lord. It is so critical for us to understand this because, you see, it's more difficult for us to kind of wrap our minds around the tithe in the sense of a currency-based world, right? But this is not a currency-based world that the Bible speaks to. It is more of a goods-based, right? So this isn't like money, although there are some illustrations in the New Testament about, you know, the widow bringing her two mites, right? Of course, there's the rich ruler, you know, sell all the stuff and give it to the poor and come and follow me. There's examples of money changing hands in the New Testament, but where the tithe originated, it was all about a tenth of your harvest and a tenth of your livestock and a tenth of all that you've been provided. You can see how it's been provided for you by God, right? You can't make the grain grow without the soil, without the rain, without the sun. You can't create the lamb. That's done through the miracle of birth, created by God. So in a sense, it's easier for us in that agrarian world to understand how God has provided all that you have. But you see, in our modern society, we have this sort of salary wage mentality. You know what I'm saying? So I agree with my employer to work so many hours or so much pay per hour, and then at the end of that time, I get a paycheck. Right? I earned that money. And it's so much easier for us to get into an I earned it, it's mine, I'll do with it what I want, when we get detached from the idea that God has provided it. God has provided it. Even in that situation, God has still provided it. We can't allow ourselves to get distracted from the fact that we do not have anything that did not come from God. I know the grammar nerds out there are just coiling right now at my double negatives, but we do not have anything. There's nothing you have that did not come from God. Period. And the tithe in the Old Testament, the tithe for us now, giving, was not so that God got his tenth and we could do whatever we want. The tithe was a reminder to God's people that everything you have comes from God. We give the first fruits so that we are reminded that everything we have comes from God. Everything belongs to God. God entrusts it to us as stewards, not owners. And the tithe was God's way of reminding his people every time they would bring their offering to God, they would be reminded of all that they got to steward in God's name. Now, what about our story today? This story makes me nervous. I don't know about you. Anybody get a little nervous when we started reading about people dropping dead in church? Yep. Yeah, I'm telling you what, some of you don't believe this is in the Bible, but you just look it up. So I want to invite you to turn to Acts 5, and if you don't have your Bible, to grab a hold of a copy in front of you there and get your eyes on a copy, just so you can, some of these, if you ever been flipping through the Bible and you come across a story that you're just like, wow, if I hadn't seen that with my own eyes, I wouldn't have believed it was in there, but it is, okay? This is, but a man named Ananias, with the consent of his wife Sapphira, that's important, sold a piece of property. With his wife's knowledge, he kept some of it back and the proceeds, and he brought only a part and laid it at the apostles' feet. And then Peter confronts him about it, and he dies as a result. And then his wife comes in, and Peter goes, well, did you sell it for such and such? Did you sell it for such? And she says, yes, that's what we sold it for. And she drops dead. Now that's kind of harsh, right? That's some serious business. That's some serious business. A couple of things we got to point out here, though. Context is everything. Context is everything. If you ever needed an example of the fact that these little numbers in your Bible are artificial and were imposed on it later, all you have to do is look at how chapter 5 begins. How does chapter 5 begin? But. Now, the same grammar nerds who were cringing at my double negative are really cringing at the fact that we started a paragraph with but. Okay? Because that's a continuation of a thought, not the start of one. You follow me? But it's all too easy for us to look, oh, 5, this must be a new thought. It's not. Look back a little earlier in the end of chapter 4. They are celebrating and praying and praising God that Peter and John have been delivered from a trial and from prison. And they gather, and it's kind of a summary at the end of chapter 4 that tees up chapter 5 for us to understand what's going on. And it says, now the whole group of those who believed, that's the Christians in Jerusalem, were of one heart and soul, and no one claimed private ownership of any possessions. But everything they owned was held in common. With great power, the apostles gave their testimony to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. There was not a needy person among them, for as many as owned lands or houses sold them and brought the proceeds of what was sold. They laid it at the apostles' feet, and it was distributed to each as any had need. Now there was a Levite, a native of Cyprus, Joseph, to whom the apostles gave the name Barnabas, which means son of encouragement. He sold a field and that belonged to him, and then brought the money and laid it at the apostles' feet. But, you got it? Have we erased that number 5 in your Bible, I hope, at this point? Okay. But a man named Ananias, with the consent of his wife Sapphira, sold a piece of their property with the proceeds, and they held some back. Do you see the pattern here? Okay. The witness of Acts here says that the whole community, anybody who had anything, was selling it and bringing what they had from the proceeds and laying it at the apostles' feet. And then it says specifically that this guy, Barnabas, this son of encouragement, that he sold a specific piece of property, and he brought it and he laid it at the disciples' feet. And then Ananias and Sapphira come, and they sell a piece of property, but they're going to hold a little back. And they're going to bring their proceeds and put it at the disciples' feet. You see the pattern here? They're bringing it and laying it at the disciples' feet is implying that they're bringing all the proceeds. But they're not. You see that? But they're not. The pattern of all of the people who were gathered in Jerusalem, all of those who were believers, were selling their property and bringing everything. But when Ananias and Sapphira bring a part of, but not all of it, they're bringing it, assuming everybody will think they brought all of it. Do you follow that? Ananias and Sapphira hold back some of the proceeds. It doesn't even say a lot. It just says some. We can assume that that was just a small portion. Maybe they just needed a little, you know, cushion. Maybe they had, you know, some things they needed to settle. Or maybe they had some stuff they wanted to do. It doesn't say. It's honestly irrelevant because they're bringing it, allowing others to assume that it's everything that they got for their property. Because that's the pattern. And they both die because of it. They both die because of it. Notice it doesn't even matter how much it was. The Bible doesn't even tell. Have you ever noticed the Bible gets very specific sometimes? Jesus tells a parable and he says this many denarii or that many mana, right? Okay, whatever it might be, or minas, okay? And we have to, of course, we don't work in those currencies. Why can't they just translate that into, you know, American currency? But we have to go and figure out what that is, right? It's this many days late, you know, wages for a laborer, etc. They're very specific. But here, notice, I just love the language here. When Peter interrogates Sapphira, because it doesn't say how much Ananias brings, but when Sapphira comes looking for her husband, Peter says, did you sell it for such and such? don't know about you, but such and such is not something I expected to find in the Bible, but it's the Bible being intentionally vague here. You don't think that Luke could have found out how much they sold it for or how much they brought? It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter how much they brought. It could have been $2. It could have been $2 million. It wouldn't have mattered because they were bringing it as though they were bringing it all, but they were only bringing some. And look. Look at what happens. Look at what happens when Peter confronts Ananias. Peter says, notice it's, Peter has no reason to know that it's only part of it, right? I don't think Peter had, you know, a spreadsheet of recent real estate sales open, you know, a little tablet there, okay? Right? It's not like he could have Zillowed it, okay? Right? But he knows. He gets a word of knowledge from God that that's not everything. That's not everything. And so Peter confronts him immediately. Ananias, Peter asks, why has Satan filled your heart to lie to the Holy Spirit and keep back part of the proceeds of the land? Why has Satan filled your heart with the lie? You see, giving wasn't about God's need. It wasn't about God's need. God could have provided for the people in Jerusalem abundantly in any way God wanted. It wasn't about providing for the need. It was about the heart of the giver. It was about the heart of the giver. Because giving, you see, isn't about what God needs. Giving is about the heart that we need to receive. You see, here's the thing. God is giving by nature. God's very nature is to give. Look at the way it's put in some other places. Matthew 7:11, Jesus teaches, if you then, who are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your heavenly Father give good things to those who ask him? This is Jesus speaking. A little bit earlier than the chapter before, Jesus says, therefore, do not worry. You remember this one? The lilies of the field and the birds of the air, right? Jesus says, therefore, do not worry, saying, what will we eat or what will we drink or what will we wear? For it is the Gentiles who strive for these things. And indeed, your heavenly Father knows that you need these things, but strive first for the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And all these things will be given to you as well. God's very nature is to be giving. God's very nature is to be giving to us. The best is Psalm 37:4. Psalm 37:4 celebrates, take delight in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. Do you hear that? Take delight in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. Ananias and Sapphira come, as Peter puts it, with Satan filling his heart to lie to the Holy Spirit. His heart wasn't right. It didn't matter how much he was bringing, his heart wasn't right. And the psalmist is saying, take delight in the Lord, put your heart in the right place, and God will give you the desires of your heart. God is giving in nature, and we read in Genesis that we are created in God's image. We are created in God's image, and sin distorts that image, as we've read before. We've talked about it. Christ comes to restore that image of God in us. Christ comes that we might be restored to the image of God, the giver. I would say it's an accident, but it's not really an accident, as my buddy Les back there will remind me every time I say it's an accident. But every time I'm writing one of these sermons, for some reason, John 3:16 pops into my head for a different reason. You know John 3:16, right? For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that those who believe in him would not perish but have eternal life. Christ comes to restore the broken image that we might reclaim our created nature as givers, that our hearts might be put back into the right order. Part of that restoration is restoring our nature in the matters of giving. It's not for God's sake. Giving is not for God's sake. God calls on us to give because God knows we need to. Because if we're going to recapture, retrace that image of God in our lives, it's going to take giving because God is a giver. Because God is a giver. Now, I could stand up here. Today is the day where I'm sure if you've been thumbing through your bulletin, you might have come across the pledge card. Right? Today's the pledge card day. Right? And I could get up here like a PBS special, right, and say, okay, the fun is over. Now it's time for you to pay the piper, okay? We know you watch PBS. We know you listen to this station, right? So what does that mean to you? What is that worth to you, right? We could do the hard sell there. We need, so please meet our need, but that's not what I'm saying today. That's not what I'm saying today. I'm saying we need to give. Because we need God in our lives. God has given and entrusted everything you have to you. And now God is saying, what have you been inspired by your faith to give back for your sake? That's what God is saying. So here's the thing. I want you to take, you see the pledge card has two sides. So you might have, this is the action portion, all right? So everybody find that pledge card, and if you didn't get your own bulletin, you should go grab your own bulletin so that you all have this pledge card, because I want you to turn to the non-money side of the pledge card, okay? We're just going to go through this for a few minutes. This is kind of your homework. We're helping you do your homework. This is in-class homework, okay? In-class homework. Now, if you're a visitor here, I don't know if there are any visitors necessarily, but if you are a visitor here, I pray that God has moved in your life to understand that giving in some form is important to you, okay? But when it comes to the ministries of this church, you know, I stand before you bringing to attention the things that we promise when we agree to be a part of this family of God, that we pledge our support to the church through our prayers, our presence, our gifts, our service, and our witness. Now, it's always been the case with me that when I put it down on paper, it seems to mean more to me. Anybody like that, right? I might have 1,000 things in my head. I had 1,000 things on my to-do list when I started on Monday this week. And I put them down on paper, and they meant something to me, and I was able to tick through them, right? But if we put things down on paper, somehow that helps. That matters. So here's my challenge to you. There isn't a person here who is a regular part of our congregation who shouldn't be filling out a pledge card right now. Okay? Now, you might not have anything to give financially. And I want you to hear me say that that is okay. That is okay. That is you and God. But I want to invite you to consider, all of the ways we give and all the ways God is calling us to give in this place. So we start with prayers. We start with prayers. Will you, I will give my time to God in prayer how many minutes every day? Yes, I'm serious, every day. Presence. I will attend public worship in the church this many weeks in the coming year. Can you put that down? Now, you might get sick. You might have something happen. And we will come and we'll pray with you about it. But as you sit right now, here in the presence of God, how often could possibly be too often to be in God's presence together? Gifts, that's the other side. We'll get to that. Service, I will serve God in ministry in the area of, what is it? It might be something you're already doing. It might be something I've just harangued you into saying yes to doing in the last week or so. You were on my to-do list, right? It might be something that you've always wanted to do or something that you've thought about doing or something you feel God nudging you to do even though you're kicking and screaming and saying, no, put it down. I will serve God in ministry in the area of fill in the blank. And then there's witness, the final one. I will share my testimony of faith, why you follow God, how Christ has changed your life. I will share my testimony of faith with and put a name. Put a name. Not someone, not a neighbor, not if it comes up, but put a name there. Who is God placing on your heart to share your testimony with in hopes that they might come to faith in Christ? And then I want you We're going to give a few moments of prayer, okay? And then I want you to fill out the other side too. If you feel moved to support the ministries of this church financially, if you feel like this could be a good storehouse for you to share what God has given to you, and you can put that down. It can be a one-time gift. It can be every month. It can be every week. However you want to do it. And then fill out your information there. There is no shame in this, okay? This is between you and God. This is between you and God. What are you going to commit to God to give? How are you going to let God retrace His image in your life through giving in the coming year? We're going to pray about that. And I'm going to, if you feel moved, you don't have to, you can drop it in the offering plate, but if you feel moved, if you feel like you need to take that step and bring it up and lay it here on the altar, I'm going to invite you to do that. And if you don't make it up here, you can drop it in the offering plate. But what are you going to commit to? How will you commit to serving God this year? Let's take a moment in prayer. Let us pray. Holy and gracious God, move in our hearts, that our hearts might be put in right order by the power of your Holy Spirit. Help us to recognize that you call us to give for our sake, that we might redeem, that we might claim your image in our lives. Lord, fill us with your Holy Spirit and encourage us to give by our prayers, our presence, our gifts, our service, and our witness to you in this world. Come and rest heavy on us in this place and move us to commitment. Lord, we offer our gifts to you in humility, humbling before you, the giver of all good gifts. We praise your name and we give you thanks for all that you have entrusted to us. We pray our giving might honor you. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Don't discount your talents and your gifts that you have to give back to God. Those little hobbies that you like to do can turn into a huge part of a ministry of a church for God. Consider that over this next week and think about how you can give back to God, because he gave it to us first. Will the ushers come forward?
Thank you.
Father, please take these gifts that we have given from our hearts and use them to give back to those who are in need. Let us go this week and be able to tithe from what you have given us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
As we make our transition from the worship of this place to the worship of our everyday lives, I do want to invite you to come forward. If you have need of further prayer following our service, you can come and be prayed for by one of our Stephen ministers, or you can remain where you're at, and they will come and find you and pray with you there. Also, make your way down to the prayer chapel for Holy Communion before you leave today. And now may we gather our voices together and join in our benediction song. May you go out into this world, givers in the image of God. Go to give generously to all you meet. Go in peace, for you are loved. Amen.
Amen.
Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see. I want to see.
Lift it up. Let me hear you.